know about relationships, but you're wrong. Listen, there's no magic bullet. I'm teaching life skills.
When he's sick, you need medicine. It don't always taste good.
Oh, nah.
But it'll get you better. You need this medicine.
Yeah.
It ain't gonna always taste good. But this is what you need. Men and women, bottom line, we need to have the conversation. Your partner wants to give up control, but only if you know how to drive. This is about being the best you could ever be, whoever you are. I don't care if you're a man, a woman, LGBTQ, space aliens. I'll save anybody. I don't care. I'll teach a hedgehog how to have a threesome.
What do you mean by that?
Look, you don't have to listen to me, but you're wrong.
Listen, I know I'm great. And I know you're thinking, Dante, there's no way I could be like you. But you could be me, you know why?
Because you know who I was? Before I was me, I was you! You!
Man score 202.
Better hear what I've got to say because you won't get it again.
I'm not an alpha male. I'm not a beta male either. I'm just a better man. Better man.
Well, put your happiness first, because if you don't, they won't.
GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted. What's going on? What's going on? I am fucking excited about this show. Really, really. We got a special guest. First and foremost, Harry, what's going on? How are you? You ready to rock and roll? I'm ready to get into this as quickly as possible.
I am ready to rock and roll. And as just a reminder, I am not white. Just throwing that out there. My okay. New catchphrase, I ain't white.
Okay.
Keeping it good. Right. Keeping it good. Right. 2021.
Dre, you ready to rock and roll? Because I want to introduce
you. Yeah.
All right. So our guest today, special guest today, really dope dude, funny dude, creative, always been good to me. I got to say that. Just done everything. Was in the documentary with Patrice, one of Patrice's best friends. Please put your hands together for Jim Norton, y'all. Give it up for Jim Norton.
Word.
I'm so bad with intros. Like, I never like introductions. Like, I just get like really embarrassed. Like, when I'm doing a set somewhere, all I want them to go is, all right, your next act. And I just kind of walk on, because if there's no expectations, can't fail. That's all it is, the fear of failure.
I really want to get into that, because it's weird to me. It's weird to me how talented and creative. And I mean, I know Jim has a rough time when you compliment him. He wants to crawl into his shoebox. But I got to say it. I got to say it. Jim is creative and talented, and he's diligent, and he's been doing this, been broadcasting for a long time, like a super, but still insecure about all the things, all that he has to that he can point to say that I'm worthy, and Jim is still weird about it.
Yeah, it's a weird fear. Like, I remember I was touring with Dice, and it was probably like 1999 or 98, and I had been doing it 9 years at that point, and I loved Dice, and we were getting ready to go on, and he goes, "You nervous?" And I'm like, well, yeah, a little. How about you? And he goes, I'm terrified. It made me laugh, because it was like, even a guy like that, who we were just doing like a 1,000-seat theater, like, you, he had done the Garden, but he still had that weird fear at times. I think it's kind of healthy, as long as it doesn't like stop you from doing shit.
And it hasn't stopped you. It's funny, because I say that was, as a kid, that's when I really started standing up for myself, because it was like in my head, like I was a really scary kid, like you know, scared of girls, scared to fight, scared. Yeah. I was real. My
scared,
dad was like,
scary. You made it sound scary, as if you frightened people.
Like,
you
I was boo. No,
it's the complete opposite.
But I remember watching Mike Tyson fight Tyrell Biggs. I don't know if you remember that fight. The guy kind of looked like Muhammad Ali, a young Muhammad Ali.
No, I remember. I mean, I remember Tyrell Biggs, but I don't remember that fight.
I'll tell you the one at the after interview was him going, yeah, every time I hit him, he was like, ooh, ow, ow, he's hurting me. I mean, you remember that interview?
No.
because I was hitting him. I could hear him making noises like a woman. Right?
Mike Tyson, the fucking greatest.
But the guy, like, he had no chance against Tyson. Everybody was like, he had no chance. And somebody, it was like, it's Tyrell Biggs, like, whatever. Somebody, the next tomato can stepping up. But they were in the room with him, and they were doing the pad work. And while they were doing the pad work, they're going, "You the greatest champ. You the greatest." Like, they were still giving him affirmations. And I was like, "You're fighting this bum. You're Mike Tyson, and somehow you still need validation." And then I was like, if Mike Tyson don't want the smoke, nobody wants the smoke.
But I don't think it's that. I don't think that's what was going on there. I think he was just staying on course. He was constantly I don't think it's on some Mike didn't want the smoke, so he needed an affirmation to remind him to, like, yeah, I'm a fighter. I don't think that's what was going on at all.
It absolutely was. That's what was going on.
I vehemently disagree.
I'll tell you why. Because here's the thing. Mike Tyson, if you go see his one man show, he talks about how he was afraid all the time. He was constantly afraid. So that was, but I'm saying that the fact that his coaches were mindful enough to boost him up. If I wasn't afraid, I'd be going, "Look, relax, I'm good. It's Tyrell Biggs. Sit down. Let's eat nachos." But it wasn't. And I always remember that in my head. It's funny when you say that about Dice, this guy who I thought was like invincible, and you go, he has fears just like everybody else.
And Tyson's so great because he talks about like low self-esteem. His book, his biography is probably the best biography I ever read.
Really?
It was really beautiful because it was completely honest. Good, the bad, everything. And really, really honest about not just the stuff that happened, but feeling like a piece of shit or feeling less than and feel like, all these things. And like, you know, for a guy like that to feel this way, it makes regular people feel like, all right, well, it's not so crazy if I feel.
Right.
I love him, man. I think he's really, really an honest guy in public life.
Yeah, and a little bit off, though. If you watch his podcast, the hot box, he gets a little crazy.
I saw the one where he's crying, talking about, who is he talking about? It wasn't Sugar Ray Leonard. It was some, no, I think it was Sugar Ray on the show with him. He was getting choked. Oh, Alexander the Great. I mixed those guys up. He was talking about
when did he fight him?
Yeah, that's what I mean. What a terrible mix up. He didn't fight either one of those guys. It was Alexander the Great he was talking about, and it was funny to watch Mike get emotional. There's definitely a step that's what I love about it, you know?
Yeah.
Which one of us don't have that shit?
Yeah.
What's that?
The fear?
Oh, that, that's nah, the point.
That little, hey, something a little wrong with you, nigga.
Little tinge.
Every one of you, all of us got that shit.
Absolutely. Yeah, why else see performers?
I think people, you take your own fear and you magnify it more because it's yours, and you don't think, it's like on a pragmatic terms, you go, oh, everybody got that, but you think about it, it's just you. It's always interesting. Yeah, I mean, I've known Norton probably 20 years now.
Yeah,
20 and Norton is always like, always not recognizing that the view that other people see you and what other people see that you've accomplished in comedy and acting and everything. It's just, it's really phenomenal, and that you still have that self-doubt, you know?
Yeah, it is a weird line with it, too. I think every performer has to have it on some level. It kind of motivates you to be good so you don't just walk up there and mail it in. But then there's the point where you just got to be careful it's not debilitating, like where you're like, oh, I'm such shit. Like, a lot of guys have that and sabotage themselves. So there's a really weird gray area between like where it can hurt you and where it can help you, and then where you can just kind of exist with it. Right. But yeah, after a while, like, I'm not good at watching myself. Like, some comedians fucking fascinate me. They can sit you down and go, look at this set I did. And then they're like, and look, hey, aren't I wonderful? And I
how is Rick Moss, by the way? How's Moss doing?
usually stink. Yeah.
Yeah, and they usually stink. It's crazy.
Yeah, I hate it. Can't watch any of it unless I'm in the process of editing. Then you can watch something you're doing because you're like, well, it's part of, I'm still doing it.
Right.
I edit it and I have to see how this worked. And you're still in fucking task work mode.
Yeah.
Work mode, yeah. Yeah, you're not in I hate my own guts mode. You're in get this done and submitted on
one
time.
One part of you has like humility about it. You're like self-aware. And then when you can like compartmentalize and be like, all right, this is a task now. I'm doing a job. You can remove the humility part. You can remove yourself, all your feelings, and just be like, I'm a computer. I'm going to just get this shit edited, get it done, and be like, I'm out.
Yeah, just watch it. I can watch it like detached. Like as I'm editing, I'm like, oh, blinking piece of shit. And I forget that it's me. You know, that's the beauty detached. Of it. I can just edit what needs to be edited, hand it in, and then never watch it again.
You always suggest a lot of CGI.
I jack off with Goldschlager naked with and baby oil with candles as I watch my sets.
Oh, you do. You enjoy them, huh?
Goldschlager?
Like, that guy. That guy right there. Jesus Christ. Who would have thought that? Huh? Yeah. Who?
That's the look you just, if you're watching yourself with someone else, just kind of go, huh? I mean, it's me. I can't believe it's me either. You know,
I'm so good.
Yeah.
But Jim, does that ever affect your personal life to some degree at all? Like, I mean,
you got a girl now, Jim? You with somebody or no?
I date, but but to answer your question, yes, destroyed my personal life. Of course it has, because I'm always convinced they're fucking someone else. Because why wouldn't they be? It wrecks my personal life, of course, because it makes you difficult, because you don't believe anything good should happen for you. So when something good happens, you sabotage it, or you don't enjoy it because you're too worried about losing it. So yeah, it definitely fucks up my
personal life. I mean, I think it's so crazy because it's almost like you're like you don't believe yourself. Do you know what I mean? It's like if you so for me, the way I get out of my head is that I make it as pragmatic as possible. Like, for instance, when I was a kid, I used to be afraid of roller coasters, and my sister used to always want me to go on roller coasters. But then I was like, I go, look, it's there's 2 hours of people online after me, right? If I die, they're not going to be able to get on the Six Flags is not made to kill me. So the whole point is the fact that we think we might die and the fact that we don't is what the fun is. But it's ridiculous for you to have a fear that you're going to die on a ride that's not set up for you to die. And then what is everybody behind you? The next 8 hours of people online, what are they going to do? Are they just going to move your body out the way? It's just it's an absurd kind of phobia that doesn't even sit in a real place. There's no founding in it.
Although all the people behind you would get on the ride. It's like a plane crash. If you hear about a plane crash, you're like, they're so rare. Great day to fly, because they never happen 2 days in a row. So if you flew off a roller coaster and died, more like, people would go on. He's like, this is not going to happen twice in a day.
I know that's the flying thing. I always try to tell myself, like, all right, listen, the odds are it's more dangerous to drive, right? And you know that. Yeah. But when that plane hits that like turbulence, it takes that like 10-foot drop. You don't give a shit about the statistics. You're like, I can't believe this is the way I'm going to die.
Yeah. I watch turbulence videos on YouTube. You go on YouTube and watch, you can watch anything now. And there's hours of videos of people hitting really bad turbulence, and it's horrifying. But then you're like, well, they all landed. Like, they're all okay.
Right.
I'm watching this video. They made it.
Or they're not.
Yeah, or they were live streaming and they're dead. Yeah, it could be one of those. It could be that too. You're right.
Oh, it's weird because it's like, why is it that you think somebody's always, like, if you're dating somebody, she's always fucking somebody else?
Just a worst case scenario thing. Like, you know, sure, it's always, it's called a catastrophizing. You know, always catastrophizing everything and seeing that it's going to be a disaster. It's probably a way of preparing yourself for any possible letdown, any possible horrible things that can happen. If you've already thought the scenario through, it's not as bad if it happens.
Now, do you think it almost doesn't quantify because of all the success that you've had? Because what I like a lot of times I'll counsel dudes and they'll always talk about a girl and they'll say that she's out of their league because she's attractive. Right. But, you know, one of the things that I will always tell dudes all the time is like if you're kind and you're civil and you're honest and truthful and you say what you mean and mean what you say, you show up when you're supposed to show up. Those things are more valuable than anybody else. Because even when the chick is with the guy with the six pack, If he's a douchebag, she's not going to like him either. You know, I mean, I think we cherry pick the best parts of everybody else. And then we're super critical about ourselves. And the things that we find most appetizing in social relationships between friends, family and relationships is honesty, credibility and empathy, you know, and those right. things. But we don't value them when they're coming from us. You know what I mean?
Yeah, honestly, yes. We see these great things in other people, but when they come from us, we kind of lower the good impact that they're going to have. Well, you right. undervalue the impact. Yeah, I agree.
A lot of times I'll tell a dude, I go, what would it be like if you had if you could clone you and had you as your best friend?
I have better pictures on Instagram for damn sure.
They go, oh, that would be cool. A guy, you know, always looks out, always, unless of course you're a scumbag. If you're a scumbag, you're like, right. nah, I don't wanna. And even then, who admits that they're a scumbag that's a scumbag, you know?
Right. I bet you if you talk to Hitler, he'd probably go, look, I'm a good egg. I'm a good egg.
Start showing you paintings and shit.
Yeah, exactly. I'm artistic. Yeah, I mean, everyone thinks they're a good guy. You're right. There's no one thinks that they're a piece of shit. You know, everyone's got their own point of view.
But that's shit about jail when they say, what you in here for? Nigga, they got me on that bullshit. Yeah. Everybody in there on some bullshit. Nobody did it. Nobody in jail ever did none of this shit.
Yeah, everyone is innocent. I saw some documentary. It was a guy who I think this guy actually was innocent and he did get out of prison. It's on Netflix now. It was a Boston case. And it really did look bad for the guy. But the Boston cops fucked up the investigation and this like Boston lieutenant, you know, we stand by our investigation. And he goes, yeah, every guy in the can wants a new trial. And it's like, yeah, I guess that's what it is. First of all, that's how a cop's, every guy in the can wants a new trial. Everyone thinks that they deserve another shot.
This is in front of an actual press conference, microphone on camera, official. Yeah. That's the spokesperson they sent out. He was the most articulate of everybody. Let's send out Tommy. He's the speaker of the group.
Yeah, forget the case. It was one of those Project Innocence things where there was like an off-duty cop guarding a Walgreens and he got shot in his car. Did you see the Netflix documentary?
Oh, yeah. I saw that. Yeah, it was a good one.
Really good.
I want to get back to the relationship stuff, but I just wanted to, you know, we got you here. I mean, we've been talking about it. What did you think of the doc? Patrice's doc?
I only watched a little bit of it. I liked what I saw.
Yeah.
I'm not good at going back. I've never seen all of Elephant in the Room.
Yeah, really? It was painful for you.
Yeah. It's too uncomfortable to watch it or listen to the old O&A clips. Because I remember a lot of that. You know, like, I stopped in when he was shooting Elephant in the Room. We had the same manager, and I stopped in.
Yeah, Branstein.
Yeah, and I watched for a few minutes, and then I left. I think I was going to the cellar. But yeah, it's kind of difficult. Like guys like him or guys like Otto, I can watch a little bit, but I can't watch too
really?
Much. Yeah, it's just unpleasant. It makes me too sad. So I little pieces I can. Yeah. Certain bits I can listen to.
I thought they did a good job. I always look at it like this. I mean, you know, when you have somebody and they die young, or like, I mean, Otto was a good dude and you know, and Greg and Mike D stuff. I mean, like, we lost so many that, but the thing is, if he was 92, you would kind of feel the same way. I know that you go, well, he died young, but what we want is more. You know, you want more, whatever it is, you want more. If your friend passes, the reality is that you're never ready to you're never going, okay, I've had enough of him, you know, if it's your friend.
Yes.
And so you're never going to, so what, you know, it's kind of our greed in a sense where we just want more of the person, even though we've had what we experienced, you know?
I would have liked a few more years because I'll be honest, I was almost finished with him anyway. I mean, 41. Patrice probably had two more good years in my life before I finally just fucking cut him off. So I would love to have gotten a couple more years. I mean, look, but I felt like my relationship with him was complete. Like, there's nothing that went unsaid. Like, I don't wish he was alive for me to say anything.
Right. You just want more.
Yeah, I mean, we knew. I knew how he felt about me, and I knew. Like, I knew he knew too. So it's not like, fuck, there's that moment that I wish.
Yeah.
You know.
No regrets.
No, none. He was with me We went and saw Richard Pryor together. The only time I ever met Richard Pryor was with Patrice.
Oh, really?
It was very brief at the Comedy Store. Yeah.
Year with this event? Yeah.
I want to say it was 95. And Patrice and I were both managed by Carolines. And like Rick Dorfman and those guys were managing people. Rick was at Carolines. So they sent us out to LA to do a like a showcase at the Improv. You'd go out there and I was on a TWA flight cross country and I was sitting next to Patrice. I was in the window and he was in the aisle. And I remember I pissed so much because I had to keep stepping over him. And he fucking told me I'm probably diabetic. He's like, you got to get yourself tested for diabetes. So we get to LA and we do the showcase and it's awful. They send Patrice up first. And
that's the worst. Tanks. Yeah.
Everyone, it's a disaster. There's 40 people in the room, whatever. It just stunk. And then at the Comedy Store was Richard Pryor. So Patrice and I went over and got to watch him. And I didn't get to talk to him. I just asked him to sign my business card because he was so
right.
Yeah, he was like, he signed like two things. He's like, I can't anymore. So I asked his wife, I'm like, I'll probably never get this chance again. I'm from the East Coast. And she's like, Richard, just one more. So he signed my business card. But yeah, that was a really... Patrice didn't meet him though. He's like, nah, I didn't. Like, he didn't go over and say anything to him.
Yeah.
He was like, nah, I didn't. You know, that's kind of how Patrice was. He, you know, there was no one that was going to kind of make him stand up and walk across the room. Not even Pryor.
With those fucking awful knees. Yeah.
and he was arrogant. You know, that was the beauty of him. You know, hey, you want to go meet Richard?
Like, nah. Yeah. Come on. Maybe 10 years ago.
Yeah.
Maybe if he walks over to him.
He's past his prime. Yeah. Patrice would be like, yeah, bring him over. Why don't you drag him over here?
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, it was it's always weird to me. Like I know you're kind of like I know that that you always you like thousands of pictures with celebrities, right? Sure. Like you love taking a picture with celebrities and stuff. In fact, I remember Patrice trashing Chuck Nice because he spoke up to give you to get a picture with or something like that.
Oh, did he? I don't remember.
Yeah, and then Patrice goes, "You piece of shit! You told that story so that you could say that you were with Alice Cooper. You fucking piece of shit."
Was he trashing me or Chuck?
No, he was trashing Chuck because Chuck was telling the story. With Alice Cooper, and Norton didn't want to talk to him, so I brought him up, and he was like, "You piece of shit, telling the story when you name drop." Yeah. But yeah, it's an interesting thing that you've always been that. I know you're kind of like a fanboy when it comes to that. But don't you in your mind it never clicks to you that you're a celebrity too? Like, do you understand that the reason why they talk to you is not just because you're a fan, it's because you're a peer?
No, well, they talk. It depends on. It's made me much like I'm very grounded with fans because I understand both sides of the coin really well. Like, I know how much someone can love you as a performer because I know that how I am with performers. And I know what it's like when they're not nice back. But no, it like when they're in the radio studio, I always get it. Like, I'll laugh sometimes. I'm like, if we were in L.A. at a party, this guy would fucking spit on me if you were deaf. But now that he's in this room, he has to answer my questions. Like, this guy literally has to engage me because he wants to promote something. Yeah. So I'll take pictures in studio, but most times they don't, I don't even think they recognize me. Once in a while they will, and that's always weird for me if they recognize something I've done. But no, I never feel like we're peers. I always feel like I'm just fucking just walking up and asking. Maybe they'll say yes, maybe they'll say
yeah,
no.
I mean, it's amazing because, I mean, you're a really pragmatic dude. It's like even when you know, I was, me and Harry was listening to one of the videos where this guy, what was the guy was, what the fuck was, oh, he was about the mask. He was on the phone.
He called up Jim and Sam and was saying that you don't need masks and that the mask thing is unnecessary and that they're not doing vaccines.
And you're a sheep. He's yelling at you. He goes, I'm listening to you and you're yelling about, and I'm agreeing with you partially anyway. And then you go, so you're a real pragmatic dude who will always kind of look at it logically and critically. It always fascinates me how you're not like that with women, because if you think about it, you like you've accomplished, like there's not one of those chicks that you think are hot have achieved it to any degree of what you achieved. They don't work as hard. They're probably not as loyal. I mean, you know that because you think they're going to be fucking somebody as soon as they leave the house anyway. So these awful, disloyal hoes. And you're not that at all. And you don't see that the value that you bring the value to their lives and not so much that they don't bring the value to yours.
Yeah, it's one of those things where you look back on it, like 10 years, when you have 10 years in the mirror, you can go, okay, it's a little easier to look at. But in the moment, no, I'm very bad at that. And yeah, when guys call up with stuff like that, like arguing or I try to like really be logical about it.
Yeah.
I think the other thinking is lazy. Like, I think it's lazy thinking to just jump up like everybody feels so proud of their dedication. It's like, shut up.
You're full of shit.
You're full of shit. Shut the fuck up, you lazy idiot, with your refusal to look at both sides because you want to dig in. But I kind of do that because I find that thinking really irritating, regardless of where it's coming from.
Yeah, I just say, you know, the chick that got fired from Vogue as the chief editor of Vogue.
Yep.
And did you know that the girl who outed her had a whole bunch of N-bombs in her Twitter? And it's like, there's no authenticity at all. Like, you know, you are a piece of shit, but you're going after this person knowing that your flank is not covered because you're dirty, and you still go. I don't even understand the concept of that.
Because everybody's lying about what they're doing. Nobody cares whether somebody has used Asian slurs or said sexist jokes or the N-word. It's about getting someone. Yeah. We love to get each other.
Yeah.
And that's just the shield we run into the room behind. The shield of honor and of you know, purifying language. It's bullshit. People just like clubbing each other over the head, but they can't say that. You know, like, it's like watching people try to find things to latch onto and people to attack. It's like watching somebody in the 50s. You ever see those tubes, a clear tube, and money blows all over and they
scramble?
That's what everybody's like on social media. Just looking for shit. You did that. You said that. None of it's sincere.
Fucking perfect.
Right.
None of it is sincere. Yeah. Everybody's doing that and then looking behind them because they're terrified of that someone's going to come for them. No one is just being truthful and going, God, it feels good to jump on somebody.
That's
why mobs, you know, mob scenes when they fucking, you ever see videos when they necklace somebody? Where they take a tire.
The burning necklace. Yeah.
You ever see the crowd around? No one ever helps that guy. They all just watch. That's social media. It's just they're more honest.
Any other normal person would have referenced the mob from Frankenstein. Jim Norton finds a way to reference an actual video of them setting somebody on fire with a tire around their neck.
Well, Frankenstein was kind of asking for it. Like, I don't know what the guy in the video did. He probably stole a microwave and people are angry at him. But the whole mob will just stand and watch. Yeah. And that's kind of how it is until it's us.
Yeah. Yeah. It's crazy that you would. I mean, just there's such a point of disingenuousness. It comes from such a disingenuous place.
Oh, no, my bad. Finish, bro. My bad. I got
The disingenuous. It comes from such a disingenuous place that you find that you're always, it's almost like you're always covering up the parts that, you know, it's like, so it's like you all, like, you know, like that whole era, your era of coming up when you were doing comedy, it was like, tell the truth. Tell the truth. You got to tell the truth. Be as close to the truth as fighting to be as close to the truth. And I don't even think, because like, I'm the generation after y'all. I'm like Big J's class of guys. And I don't even think that you guys even understood the dynamic of what was going on because y'all were living in it. And with so many good guys, so many different styles packed into the cellar at one time, just working. And you guys were really pushing each other indirectly and directly. You were pushing each other because everybody was working to be original and unique and so on. So, and I remember just because I started, you know, I was an older guy, like I'm your age now, but I didn't start doing comedy till 2000, but watching y'all and just how oblivious you were to this competitive creative spirit was in there every day, the way you guys were pushing each other. It reminds me of like old hip hop, like 80s and 90s hip hop. Like EPMD and Tribe Called Quest and those. It was like that. But y'all was so in it, I don't even think you even recognized it, because it was like we were like off watching it, you know?
Right. And now is the age of everybody is like there's literally comedians that are trying to have other comedians punished for things they say. And yeah, it's like that's like hip hop. That's where the hip hop war escalated. Well, yeah. That's kind of how, like, you know, we were from the different era. Where you know, hey, you're a sucker MC. Like, that's as far as it went.
Player hate was a big problem back in the day.
It's a lot of player haters.
Hey, yeah, don't bite my rhymes, you. You know, like, it didn't get up to the next thing where you were trying to wreck anybody's fucking life.
Yeah. The irony is
making fun of each other.
The comedy beef has become all snitching. Like, it used
hip hop. The whole concept of comedy beef is bullshit. Yeah. Man, nigga, there's no comedy beef. It's fuck. It's pussy. It's fake ass people doing weird shit. Cause don't nobody actually want to hit each other. There's no real beef.
No.
You do not
want to
hit me, nigga. You do not have a problem with me.
You're right. They don't want the smoke. But it's funny because it's like I wonder how
they using beef to try to get their career.
Jim, did you see the Tekashi 6ix9ine documentary?
I didn't know. Is it on Hulu? I actually think it started.
Yeah, I think it's Showtime. I think Showmax or something like that.
I'm gonna watch it because I'm such a fan of the music.
You know what's crazy? The fact that you're not a fan of the music is really what's like. This kid literally understood social media. He understood the way people thought in a way that was almost freakish, down to the rainbow hair. The way he, you know, when you watch, he co-opted the Bloods to give him this kind of street credibility, and then when he snitched on the feds, got him, and he snitched on it. He made it okay to snitch. Like, he was just doing videos on Instagram like, yeah, I snitched on him. And it was a situation. And I'm like, the fact that you can even change the perspective of that snitching is okay or snitching is something, it's like, shit is bonkers.
I don't know if he changed the perspective on that, though.
But with those young kids who follow him,
maybe for like the 14-year-old or some shit.
But you grew up.
I see what you mean.
You know what I'm saying? But those young kids are like, that follow him, like 700 million people on YouTube. Like, and he says it's okay to snitch. And now they're going, it's okay to snitch.
He also did give a reason for it, though. I think he said, like, and again, I don't know the whole story, but he's like, hey, you kidnapped me. You tried to run. Like, he reasons that
don't make it okay. Because once you start banging, you signed up. It's just like the army. Once you put on the suit, nigga, you win the team. Whatever happened.
Yeah, and
so you start flagging, you start banging, you throwing up your set. Whatever go down after that, you joined up for.
Yeah.
You don't get to say I'm a civilian now.
So you have to handle it according to the rules of what you signed
you
up for.
Yes, you decided to join that squad.
There is an ethic. They even though it might be a little barbaric, there's still an ethic to it. There's rules to it.
And the only reason it's called barbaric is because they don't have the money and the funds to make it look like a fucking golf club. They have rules, regulations, the way shit's supposed to be done. That's why I don't throw up no fucking signs, because I'm a civilian.
Yeah.
If you're throwing up signs and shit?
You
live in that lifestyle, signed up, boy.
But Andre, you were in a gang of sorts when you did that off-Broadway production of Grease, right? When you were in middle school.
You know what I'm saying? I had to do my work. Fucking baby. You know what I'm saying?
When you were in middle school.
Andre can't even snap. You couldn't snap. You throw it in here. We heard you. You can't snap.
I did it.
You suck. Come on, son.
Yeah.
How you gonna be a jet and you can't snap?
Yeah,
come on, son. It's a long time.
You know about that? The documentary is called "Supervillain: The Making of Tekashi 6ix9ine."
Yeah, it was
on Showtime.
You will really dig it, because I'm not a fan of his music either. But it was just like I just kept hearing about this guy, and I said, let me watch this shit, and it was insane the way he manipulated the public to the point where he's literally almost untouchable, because he's uncancelable. You know what I'm saying? So the same thing that makes people able to be canceled is the same thing that makes you uncancelable.
Yeah. Like, and he, I was saying, he's a guy, but he has other, you have to, because the people he told on, and again, I'm not in that.
Yeah. Oh, he's getting smoked.
I would be a smoked snitch in a second, but if it was prison or tattle, I tattle in a second. But I would tell them that when I joined.
Right.
I need some help because I can't fight, but if something happens, I am telling an immediate.
You're doing your hour special at the Miskoff Theater, and you go, listen, guys, this coup d'etat, bloods, but if they ask me any questions, I'm telling on you. So
they would know that immediately. As soon as I got called out for questioning, they'd be like, where are you going? I would be like, to tell on you. That's where I'm going.
He's like, they'll be like, that's why we didn't tell you nothing. All right, have fun. We'll see you when you get back.
But yeah, that looks bad for them. That looks bad for them because like when in the old, and I'm not saying I want anything bad to happen to the guy. I don't care. You know, I have no horse in that race.
Right.
Like the mob and the reason people.
Oh, they're going to get you.
Yeah, eventually, but maybe they won't. I mean, who knows? Yeah. Like the mob, Sammy the Bull came out of.
Yeah, he's doing a podcast.
Yeah.
He's doing a podcast and talking about his murders on the Sammy podcast.
Yeah, Sammy Gravano. Yeah.
Ain't that some white shit? Damn. That is the whitest shit I've ever fucking heard. That's the whitest damn thing in the world.
He's straight talking about his murders. Oh, my God.
I don't want to hear a single white man tell me a goddamn thing about shit ever again. Let me tell you
something. Listen.
Y'all got some nigga doing a podcast about bodies.
Yeah, I signed up for his Patreon. What are you talking about?
I'm a buddy. Patreon.
Personally, I can't wait for him to do an ad read for DraftKings.
And y'all mad at OJ. Suck my dick.
I love OJ. First of all, you know what I love about OJ right now? Is that he's on Twitter, but he's saying all these very woke things so that he can't be angry at what he's saying, except for the fact that it's coming from OJ. So when OJ talks about police brutality and he talks about Black Lives Matter, and he's on there angrily, like as if he didn't murder two people.
Who? What? What do you do? Shut up, Harry. What do you do? Leave the man alone. Sammy the Bull got a fucking podcast.
That's true. I'd sign up for the OJ podcast.
I just want to hang out with OJ because I want to just smash on his giant head for like hours. Jesus, he's got the biggest head I've ever seen in my life.
Sammy's interesting, though. The stories he tells... And he always leaves a little, like, he'll go, something happened to him. Like, he won't actually tell you. But he did kind of admit that in court. He had to. I think he had to own, like, 19 murders, but legally.
Yeah.
And then he turned on Gotti. But he's the guy who snitched. But again, he did it because Gotti turned on him. He heard
tape.
And it was like, what are you going to do? Gotti's ready to throw you to the... So anyway, but he's the guy that kind of came out. And I think he's like, come get me. Yeah. And that people know that, like, he's a problem. Yeah, the fucking problem. Like,
so they was like, we're not trying to fuck with this guy and get caught up.
Also,
on some code
from 25 years ago. To everybody's moved on. Like, hey, we're stealing cable and data, and like, you know, it's all hacker shit now. We're not worried about cigarette cartons. But
he's a good storyteller, though. It's actually he's a really interesting. I don't belong to the Patreon, but I listen to some of the clips. I'm like, he's a fucking interesting guy. Like, they're really good stories.
Yeah. Oh, yeah. Well, I mean, how do you get interesting? You get interesting by doing shit.
Murdering stuff. 19 people.
Yeah, you get a couple murders that make you a real interesting guy. Yeah, Jesus.
Fucking podcast.
And it's killing. His podcast is killing.
Oh, I'm
and
sure.
A mound of niggas in jail for bubblegum.
They should be podcasting. They should be
podcasting. I don't want to hear shit from nobody.
They should be podcasting. That's what I'm
saying. To talk Tekashi 6ix9ine, like the problem though is that it's a generation of people who
there's
no integrity. Like there's a whole generation of men, young men especially, that has no integrity about stealing or snitching or like doing rock
loyalty,
shit.
No loyalty, no code, no nothing. It's just it's crazy. It's just like and the amount I'll tell you, this is the same thing. There was this kid years ago. Who had taken? He had taken a bit, like one of Patrice's bit, and did a video for it. And somebody sent it to me, and I called him. But the
it was
kid,
Kane
the,
Carter.
Kane Carter, yeah. And we, so the guy, but he was just he was a fan. He was a fan of the Black Phillip Show, and he was a fan of that. And he just did it as a bit, like it was his, and never gave credit, right? And I said, look, this is wrong. It's somebody else's bit. Blah blah blah. Whatever, whatever. And they his fans came at me, yo, you old motherfucker. Why you ain't got no neck? Like every day, eating dick. Where's your neck? You know, they smashed me. I had 500 fucking DMs every day I woke up with these motherfuckers. But it was like nobody ever said, he's doing a joke. What does it matter? Like, there was no idea of like what's shit. Right or wrong.
Got no neck.
Got a neck, motherfucker.
Dante got several neck tattoos.
So did he ever, I remember that, vaguely remember that happened. Did he ever talk about it?
He came on the show. He actually came on the show. He came on our show and he apologized. And then he was like, he was just a fan. And that was kind of, he was saying that's kind of how they meet each other. Like this, on this internet thing, these YouTubers, they diss each other and then they go back and forth and people listen, like wrestling, you act like a heel or whatever. And they go back and forth. They generate, but they get followers on both sides. They get everybody. And then they do a collaboration.
Yeah.
But I mean, it was just weird to me that there was no understanding of like, this is not yours. Like just a basic fundamental. This is not your material. This is, you've done nothing. You just scraped the cream off the top and you just took it. Like whatever how we work on being honest and getting up on stage and honing your craft and for somebody to just take the cream off, it's real crazy. But that's the thing with Tekashi 6ix9ine. It's like, these kids are so young. Your followers give you validation. I was wondering what you thought about that. Do you think that it's going to swing back or?
No, whatever way it's swinging, it will never swing back. Yeah. No, that language and all that stuff, it will never go back, because with every generation, as they push us down the assembly line into the garbage where we belong, believe me, as you get older, nobody behind you gives a fuck. They don't want to hear it. They don't want to hear, as we're like on a conveyor belt going away, going, but you don't understand. If you start punishing people for what they think, and they're like, shut up, old man, get the fuck out of here. They don't want to hear it. But the beauty is, like, now that who's right, Gen Z is, millennials are right behind us, right?
Yeah.
They're starting to take the beatings. So it's really fun to watch.
Yeah, yeah.
They're taking the beatings now.
Yeah.
And then eventually the next, it's kind of a part of it where every generation thinks that they have the right balance. I know the difference between integrity and being, like, everyone thinks they have the right balance. Everyone older thinks you're an idiot, and everyone younger thinks you're a fucking racist, a xenophobe, a homophobe, That's how it is. It's never going to change. So no, it won't swing back.
Yeah. I mean, I wonder, because you feel like, I was talking to Joe DeRosa. I don't know why I was doing that.
Yeah.
But he was saying that, you know, all these people are getting caught up. Like, there's so many dudes are getting caught up with, you know, the whole Me Too thing. And even that's kind of like weaned off a little less. I mean, it's not like I'm a mayor or nothing, but I think it swings, it goes really extreme and then it comes back. Like, I mean, even with the Me Too stuff, it's not as prevalent as it was. Do you know what I mean? Or do you just think that people, you know, they got everybody who they were going to get?
No, I think it's still prevalent, but I think what happens is, there's so many times where like something will happen and then all of a sudden an explanation will come up or a person will just go away. So it's like anything else. There's so much of it. People are all just kind of looking in different directions. Oh, look at that one. Look at that one. Look at that one. It just seems like it's not the central story anymore. But for the last year, COVID has been the central story. Like, you know, whatever the central story is, but after Harvey Weinstein, Bill Cosby, guys who are on that level.
Yeah. Yeah.
Hard to find guys on that level of famous or that level of powerful, you know. But I think that for that to have the main stage again, it would have to be somebody who's on that level. And it's not that easy to find.
Yeah, yeah. Go ahead.
Being somebody in the public eye, does that ever affect how you date or relationships and stuff? Like,
Jim's honest though. He's an honest dude.
Right, right. But I mean, is that even in the back of your head even ever?
No. No, honestly, it's not. I've always been paranoid. I've been paranoid for over 20 years. So I've always been really careful. And again, I don't drink. So I think a lot of guys, when they're drunk, do really things that they don't remember. Yeah. Yeah. Half the times they don't remember. But no, not really. I mean, I'm always surprised when somebody is attracted to me. I mean, it doesn't matter why. I'm always like, oh, good. That's great news. So no, it doesn't. I've never run around and went, she's going to want to fuck me. She's going to want to fuck me. I'm always like, yeah, all right, thank you.
Still, to this, You're at least grateful. I mean, that's kind of nice. Yeah, you're like, sure. Every time someone fucks you, you give them a nice thank you note out of gratitude.
And a tip. Of course, and a tip. It's not for free.
But what's it been like dating wise lately, Jim? How is everything going for you?
It's okay. I mean, it's hard in this time.
Yeah.
For I think everybody and dating apps, I failed miserably on. I've tried them. I just, there was nothing there. I mean, it was one. I think the last real hurrah on a dating app was when I got stood up in LA. I was going to a friend of mine had this big party and there was going to be like some really cool people there. And this girl was in the business and she totally stood me up. And I was like, I just can't rely on dating app. I just can't do it. You know? So yeah, it's been kind of miserable like it is for most people.
You know, I mean, it's funny because even though there's a paranoia, but when you say there's a paranoia, you're like paranoid about, like, you're always looking over your shoulder anyway, when it comes to everything, not just the women thing, the whole, just,
everything since day one, everything. I've always wanted to check motives and be careful of what somebody is saying to me. And can I believe this? All way too much. I probably saved myself a lot of trouble doing that, and I probably also cost myself a lot of good experiences.
Yeah, like, I mean, why do you think that comes from?
I don't know. Maybe it's. I honestly don't know. I don't really have a good answer for you. I don't know.
Did you grow up with both parents?
I did. Yeah, both my parents are still alive. Yeah, they're still married. 53 years.
Wow.
Yeah.
And just like, are they outgoing or are they? You know, what's your dad like?
They're nice people. My dad is he's got a lot of friends, a good guy, retired, postal worker. He was in the military. Really, he's a really nice man. And my mother, they do like hospice work. They're just nice people.
Yeah. It's always fascinates me that kind of disconnect between, you know, what you accomplish and what you think you're worth. You know what I mean? I think it's because I had a thing the other day where I was doing some gig on a roof and this is a younger comic and she just, you know, she had cut her hair and it was like curly. And I go, wow, your hair looks really nice. But it wasn't, I'm trying to fuck you. It wasn't an older comic who shall remain nameless. He just goes on this crazy diatribe about I don't even subscribe to that kind of complimenting a woman and demeaning her sexuality. And he just goes on and on and on and on. But what's interesting is like he's being sarcastic, like he's doing this whole over the top. And because there was an honesty into the compliment that I was given in the first place, she didn't take it creepy. She just, in fact, she was like, oh yeah, I cut it and it's shorter now. I kind of like it. You like it? It's not, you know, just, it was just really kind of honest. But I think what happens is when people are not authentic and genuine about their compliment or when there's something else behind it, they're worried about how it's going to be taken, because there's almost like they mean something behind it. Do you know what I mean? It was just an honest kind of compliment from me. Yo, what's up? We're going to close this out and then we're going to take the rest of this talk on the other side, on the Patreon side. No, don't forget, go to patreon.com/manschool202. Go follow us there. Come on and support us so we can keep doing this. Let's shut it down, yo. Jim, thank you so much for doing this, man. I appreciate
happy to do
it.
This was fun,
I appreciate
man.
You so much, man. It's good talking to you. You know, I always get a good feeling when I see you, bro. Always
yeah,
a
you
good
too,
dude.
Buddy.
Yeah. Anything you want to plug?
No, Jim and Sam on Sirius, and I got a couple of gigs going up for sale probably for August, but I'm just starting to get back on the road. But no, just Jim and Sam.
And did they ever do anything with that your thing, that special that you were doing, the thing that we shot? Remember the thing we shot with the wheelchair?
Was that for Vice?
I don't know.
It might have been for Vice. No.
Brandstein did it. No. Yeah, yeah.
No, okay. IFC. It was an IFC pilot. It might have been IFC. Yeah, no. Didn't get picked up.
Didn't
unfortunately.
Get picked.
Yeah.
Yeah. Unfortunately. Harry, go ahead.
You can check all my stuff at Harry Turjanian, my website, ihatecomedy.com. Also, check out Man School 202 YouTube page. You can see the video of this. And we're on TikTok now, too. So Man School 202 on TikTok.
Dre, talk to me.
Hip hop. Hip to the hip to the hip. Hip hop. You don't stop. You're rocking with the bang bang.
Dre, you want your credits?
We weren't passing the mic, Dre. We were just, you got to do plugs.
And
here.
Andre D. Thompson, Slouch Theory, and, you know, good stuff. Yeah.
Yeah, everything, you can check me, Dante Nero. Google me. I'm in. Also, I have the one-on-one consultations at DanteNero.com. Click on consult and you can talk to me. GYBB, get your balls back. WWDD, what would Dante do? The sexual revolution is being podcasted. Yo, I love y'all, man. Thanks for listening. Holla at y'all later. Thanks, Jim.
All right.
Man School 202 is created by Dante Nero. Hosted by Dante Nero with Harry Turjanian and Andre D. Thompson. Produced by Harry Turjanian. Executive producers Matt Kleinschmidt, Harry Turjanian, and Dante Nero.